On today's episode of Supreme Court Saturday, we're talking Trump v. Hawaii. Oh man, first the volcanoes, then the president? When will Hawaii catch a break? Yes, this case is exactly what it sounds like. The president is suing a state in the Supreme Court. So, what happened? Did the president have a bad vacation? Watch the movies Aloha and Pearl Harbor back to back in a marathon that would make even Bruno Mars hate his home state? Nope. As you can probably imagine, it's something slightly less funny.
Just hours after a federal judge in Hawaii blocked President Trump's new executive order on travel, a federal judge in Maryland also ruled against that ban. President Trump is vowing a bitter fight, even promising to take it all the way to the Supreme Court.
Well, congratulations, sir. You have succeeded. Yes, this might seem like a throwback episode, but the travel ban has been passed from court to court like a pipe at a Willie Nelson concert. For the people who aren't aware, the second version of this ban includes...
New to the list, Venezuela. In Asia, North Korea. And in Africa, Chad. Still on the list, Iran, Libya, Syria, Yemen, and Somalia. Dropped, Sudan.
People from those countries cannot come to the U.S. Ah, thank God we stopped all those North Koreans immigrating here. Anyways, as we get into later, critics saw the addition of North Korea and Venezuela to the list as, essentially, the political equivalent of saying, I'm not racist, I've got a black friend. Because the previous version of this list was conspicuously Muslim, which led to...
Sent back tonight for Donald Trump's travel ban.
A federal judge ruled it's unconstitutional, and late tonight, Customs and Border Patrol told airlines around the world the U.S. will accept all passengers who have valid travel documents.
Now, no matter what you believe, this case is very important and definitely not a foregone conclusion in either direction, because...
Now the Supreme Court justices issuing orders letting the so-called travel ban from six nations deemed as terror threats to be enforced in its entirety while the case is being litigated.
It's been going on this whole time? Talk about out of sight, out of mind. So let's join together to hear the debate about whether this travel ban is constitutional.
We'll hear argument today in case 17-965, Donald Trump, President of the United States versus Hawaii.
All right, so what's the problem? Well, the first problem isn't so much with the immigration policy itself, but more with the fact that the man who created it might be racist and using this piece of legislation to push his ideas without actually helping anyone. Now, bear with me, because this might sound more subjective than whether it's Laurel or Yanni.
It's Laurel. But I could deflect and divert to Yanni if you need me to.
Sarah, it's been reported that you hear Laurel. How do you respond?
Clearly you're getting your information from CNN, because that's fake news. All I hear is Yanni.
Who's Yanni?
I hear Covfefe.
Okay, so yes, this might seem subjective, but that's one of the major arguments.
So let's say in some future time, a president gets elected who is a vehement anti-Semite and says all kinds of denigrating comments about Jews and provokes a lot of resentment and hatred over the course of a campaign and in his presidency, and asks his cabinet members to issue recommendations so that he can issue a proclamation of this kind. This is a out-of-the-box kind of president in my hypothetical. And...
We don't have those, Your Honor.
You get it? Because that sounds just like the president instituting racist policies based on his speeches. Also, I'm sorry, but did the president's attorney just sarcastically say, we have nothing like that here, to keep the crowd going? It reminds me of the famous Johnny Cochran saying, if the glove doesn't fit, I'm full of... Well, I can't say that last word. Anyways, Trump, this might be one of the few times you might actually want to have Michael Cohen tag in. Alright, so what next? Well, with all good arguments, there are two sides. First, let's hear what the White House spokesperson has to say.
This is not a so-called Muslim ban. If it were, it would be the most ineffective Muslim ban that one could possibly imagine, since not only does it exclude the vast majority of the Muslim world.
He's right, guys. This isn't a Muslim ban because it doesn't cover 92% of Muslims. Following that logic, it's not racist for me to put in a hiring process that specifically says don't hire people named Marshawn, because most black people have other names. This argument did go deeper, though, as it was repeatedly and somewhat justifiably explained that
have the extensive worldwide process that we had that resulted in a cabinet-level recommendation that applied a neutral baseline to every country in the world, concluded that almost all the world, including almost all of the Muslim majority world, passed that baseline, but a tiny number of countries didn't.
Yes, guys. This was based on an algorithm that was universally applied, and those were the violators. Now, this immediately gave the travel ban more legitimacy in my eyes, because I like numbers and algorithms a lot more than I like the president putting together a list of countries he thinks sounds scary and banning people from them. Furthermore,
neither the visa waiver program nor any of the other statutes that they cite addresses whether we get the minimum level of information needed to determine the admissibility of individuals coming in from some of the riskiest countries in the world.
We haven't really had a policy before in dealing with a lack of information from countries we get immigrants from. Generally, in those circumstances, we put the onus of proving innocence on the immigrant looking to enter the country, along with more interviews than a disgruntled ex-Trump employee. But all of this is to figure out who the person is. Instead, in this case, we would be addressing this lack of information by punishing the countries, by withholding the ability of its citizens to get into this country. Which, wow, someone's pretty confident. Anyways, this further gave credibility that this might have less to do with Islam and more about information in general. Then he kept defending it and, well, he might have wanted to plead the fifth. Because when people pointed out that, you know, if you have a data set you are going to plug into the algorithm before you create the algorithm, you could definitely tailor the algorithm to give you whatever result you wanted. And to that, he had to say,
just like all of us here, is duty-bound to protect and defend the Constitution. So I would expect that if any cabinet member were given that order, that cabinet member would refuse to comply or resign in the face of a plainly unconstitutional order.
Oh, woof. You're telling me this relies on the integrity of politicians? Reassuring. Because this system was put in place based on a non-judgmental algorithm, well, can I just get a quick peek at it? I mean, you can end the conversation right here if you can just show me that the equation isn't Muslim equals bad.
The government had kept confidential and refused to share, either with the litigants or the courts, exactly what was done, how, what the evaluation and how it was applied to all those countries in the world.
Great. Now this still doesn't prove any wrongdoing. I'm of the belief of innocence until proven guilty. But it's odd, and the reason why it wasn't revealed wasn't revealed. He went on to say his second, equally reassuring defense.
If you had an extreme scenario where all of that broke down, then if the president actually did make that statement, I want to keep out a particular race or a particular religion no matter what, that would undermine the facial legitimacy of the action, even under the Mandel standard. Here, however, you don't have anything like that.
You know what? He's right. If I could, say, go on YouTube and find a clip of Donald Trump saying something like,
Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States,
then that would really hurt his case. For those of you who think I'm wrong, here's the White House representative in this case. Before I roll it, the proclamation in question is the travel ban.
You said something earlier, General. I want to make sure that I got it right. You said if at the time the president had said we don't want Muslims coming into this country, that would undermine the proclamation. Did I get you right?
Yes.
Well, this case is not looking good for you, my friend. Checkmate, right? Well, no, because
we are very much of the view that campaign statements are made by a private citizen before he takes the oath of office and before, under the opinions clause of the Constitution, receives the advice of his cabinet, and that those are constitutionally significant acts that mark the fundamental transformation from being a private citizen to the embodiment of the executive branch.
He's right. We can't hold politicians accountable for what they say in their campaigns. If we did, the world would be a utopia with a negative tax rate, unrealistic growth, a closed Guantanamo Bay, and a Mexico-funded wall. So yes, candidate Trump talked about banning Muslims, but President Trump has been much more reserved on this issue, putting on just a spritz of Islamophobia rather than dumping the whole bottle on himself. So things get more muddled from here because...
Tomorrow he issues a proclamation disavowing those statements.
Absolutely.
The next day he could re-enter this and your discrimination argument would not be applicable.
And Mr. Chief Justice, that's exactly what I told the Ninth Circuit in May. The president didn't do that.
Okay, that sounds reasonable. If the president said, yeah, I was wrong. Muslims shouldn't all be banned. They're fine. Well, then this would be a harder case. The problem, he kind of did.
Well, the president has made crystal clear on September 25th that he had no intention of imposing the Muslim ban. He has made crystal clear that Muslims in this country are great Americans, and there are many, many Muslim countries who love this country, and he has praised Islam as one of the great countries of the world. This proclamation is about what it says is about.
All right, that might not sound like much to a skeptic, or anyone capable of critical thinking. But if you want to make the argument that we should be holding the president accountable for what he said, well, he said that. And I could definitely picture the president saying, Islam is one of the greatest countries in the world. So there's the debate over whether this ban is motivated by discrimination or not. But now to the deeper question. Does it matter? I mean, people on both sides probably agree it does, but for opposite reasons. But does it matter from a legal standpoint? I mean, let's just say this was proven to be a straight-up Muslim ban. Besides saying, dick move, bro, what's the statutory argument for why we can't ban Muslims? First, we have the Mandel test, which came from the Supreme Court case of, oh wow, give me a second on this one, Kleindienst versus Mandel. This case dealt with the last belief to scare the heck out of this nation, communism. A well-respected communist was going to speak at Stanford University, but his visa process was stopped after, well, we realized he was a communist. Basically, this test says that when the president uses his executive power to ban a group of people based on their beliefs, it has to be backed up using a legitimate rationality, say national security, rather than just a, nah, I don't like those people. So with that, we can now briefly segue into a less moral version of this story and into a more statutory problem that this ban faces. As I alluded to above, Congress already has a perfectly good solution to the problem that this travel ban aims to solve, a lack of information.
There's only one problem he's identifying, which is countries not cooperating. He's not talking about people coming in or something like that, like your hypothetical. And with respect to that, Congress has said, here's how we deal with it. We deal with it with the individualized vetting system, which pushes all the burdens on a person coming in. That's 1361. You've got to show biometric ID under the statute. You've got to have an in-person interview. If there's any risk that the person is from a country that's a state sponsor of terrorism, like your hypothetical, or anything else. So Congress has really said, or in a robust way, here's how we would deal with it. And to the extent countries aren't cooperating, we offer carrots.
Yeah, so if that country doesn't give us information, we generally figure it out, rather than burning everything to the ground and seeing what grows from the ashes. On the other hand, the White House argued that the president is acting under Statute 1182F, which, oh man, what a boring-sounding statute! Didn't even make the first 100, and even further, it didn't even make the A, B, C, D, or E of that number. Woof! It got mentioned so many times in this case, though it must be relevant. Well, it is, and honestly, this might be the best argument for the travel ban. Because, well, it's the first section of this nation's entire legal system that didn't read like a John Steinbeck novel that had been rewritten by William Shakespeare. In simple English, it says, whenever the president finds that the entry of any aliens or of any class of aliens into the United States would be detrimental to the interests of the United States, he may, by proclamation, and for such period as he shall deem necessary, suspend the entry of all aliens or any class of aliens as immigrants or non-immigrants. Yeah, wow, very little room for interpretation on that argument. The biggest argument for why this doesn't apply is that
it has been suggested in one of the briefs that we read 1182F to allow the president to suspend entry, but only for a period of time long enough for Congress to say yay or nay.
Emphasis on a short time. This was put in so that you could handle a problem and then bring back immigration. But the time constraints and the end goal are a little bit more ambiguous in this case. According to the plaintiff, turns out,
until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on.
Not a great deadline. The ambiguous end date and the whole racist angle are the reasons people are arguing this is unconstitutional. So until next time, aloha. And that's the goodbye aloha, not the hello aloha. And as always, that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly episodes of Supreme Court Saturday. And as always, leave me a comment if you have an important case you think I should research. And thank you for watching.